Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to the last session of today. I'm the guy standing in between you and the beer out there. So we're going to talk about how you can get started with Azure Machine Learning. So my name is Henk Boelman, and I'm a cloud solution architect at a smart startup called Heroes in Den Bosch. I have a Twitter, and I have a GitHub. And everything you're going to see today, all the demos, you can find back on my GitHub later on, accompanied with a blog post. I'm also the organizer of the Global AI Bootcamp, together with the Mixed Reality User Group, who is standing there. And the next AI Bootcamp will be on the 14th of December. So if you're interested in getting your hands dirty with some AI things, mark this date in your agenda. So I think every developer, or at least me, have like those moments in your career that you're like, wow, what is this? Yeah, something new, something exciting. And for me, that were actually three moments. The first moment was the moment I got a computer and that I realized that I could outsource a little bit of my intelligence to that machine. So I didn't have to do math and all those kind of things. I could let the machine take care of that. The second one was that the internet came into my house and that I could get like more intelligence in my house. And I started programming and learning things. And the third part, the third thing, was actually quite recently. It was like 2 years ago. And it was that AI things, AI tooling, became available for me as a C# developer. I've been developing for 15 years websites. So I'm not like a very smart guy that can do all the machine learning things. But it became available for me. It came to Azure, through the cloud, to my house, and to my computer. So today, in this session, I wanted to give you a small overview of Azure Machine Learning, from what is there, what is in the cloud, what can you use. I'm going to show you how the data science process looks like, so a little bit how that process goes, so what you have to know, what you have to do. And then I'm going to show you how you can actually train your own custom model in Azure Machine Learning service. Machine learning. So what is machine learning anyway? So, and that is the ability to learn or make your computer learn without explicitly programming your computer. I've done a lot of if-then-else statements, a lot of while things, a lot of loops. But here it is just give your computer a bunch of examples and it will figure it out for you. So I really had to rethink a little bit about how that works. So I'm going to show you how that works today. So if we look what is out there on the machine learning stack in Azure. So we have like a layer of like pre-trained models that you can just consume by calling an API. Very easy. It supports all of the popular frameworks. So you can run TensorFlow on it, Keras on it, ONX models. So you can train everything on it. There are a lot of productivity services that will actually help you train your models, zoals Azure Databricks for your data cleaning and Azure Machine Learning services for the actual training part. And there is a set of machine learning virtual machines that have like pre-installed all the different versions of Python and all those things, because trust me, it is like a nightmare to get all your Python packages right on your laptop. So you can just get that out of the box. Then, of course, there are a bunch of very expensive virtual machines with GPUs you can use. And of course, you can deploy it to the cloud and to the edge, and Azure DevOps will help you with that. So if we have a look at the pre-trained models, they're divided in four categories. So we have vision, speech, language, and knowledge. So vision to make your computer see, speech to talk and to listen, language to understand what is being spoken, and knowledge, if you think it is a smart idea, to hook up your website or your application to the Bing search engine. So if we look at the vision part, there is a face API. It could tell you a lot about someone's face. There is an emotions API. It tells you a lot about someone's emotions. There is a computer vision API. It can tell you a lot about an image. And all these services work out of the box. just you don't have to do much to make it work and actually understand what AI is to use them. It can also detect celebrities in pictures and just tells you where they are actually. It can do out-of-the-box OCR, so it can read handwriting and type text. There is a custom vision service where you can bring your own images and train like a model just by clicking a train button. Show you how that works a little bit later. And there is Azure Machine Learning Studio, an easy drag and drop tool where you can create your own models and expose them through an API. So I don't want to talk about this too long. So there are a lot of out-of-the-box pre-trained models, like the computer vision API. There are services like the Face API, which you can configure and give like examples of faces, and that, so it knows that that person is Hank. There are like bring your own data services, like custom vision. You give it a bunch of images, tag it, and hit a button. And there are drag and drop tools, like Azure Machine Learning Studio, where you can create a machine learning project without programming. So if we look at cognitive services, if your boss asks you, hey, let's do some machine learning or do some AI, first have a look if it is actually in this stack. There are 42 of these services, and you can really quickly make a POC to see if it works. But now back to a better question, a real-world question. Is this a cat or is this a dog? And I'm going to show you how we can solve that using machine learning. But first, let's have a look what the data science process actually is and what you have to do to get actually to the machine learning part. So first, you have to ask a sharp question because machine learning can answer questions. So think of a good one. You have to collect data, and that mostly takes around 80% of the time because if you ask the company or someone, give me your data, then it is always like, mwah. Takes a while for you actually have it. Then you have to prepare your data. So that means clean it up and make it ready to go through your machine learning algorithm. Then you have to select which algorithm you're going to use or you're going to create your own. Actually train the model. And if your model is trained and actually ready, you can actually use it in production. So that is a thing lots of people forget to actually put it in production. So first, ask a sharp question. So which questions can you answer a machine learning algorithm? And that are actually only five types of questions. That is, how much or how many? Is it this or is it that? Is it weird? To which group does it belong to? And which action should I take? So that are basically the five questions you can ask an algorithm. So for this example, this walkthrough, we're going to answer the question, what is the price of a second-hand car? So now we have our question. So if you start your project and someone asks you to do an AI project, ask them, which question do you want to have answered? And then you start with the data and all the other things. So when you have formulated your question, you can start collecting the data. And there is a lot of data out there. So yeah, oh well, of course, your company has lots of data, but there are also some resources like Kaggle and UCI, and even Azure Machine Learning Studio that has like a bunch of sample data and cool data sets to play around with. And they're mostly already pretty clean, so you don't have to do much of the work. So for this, I've downloaded the data set with like millions of records of secondhand car sales. And I've put them in this tool to see what is actually in that data set. So I have my data now. I got it from the website Kaggle. And now I can start preparing the data. So if you start preparing the data, for every column, you have to ask yourself a few questions. Is this column relevant to answer my question? Is this column independent I will tell you about that later. Is the data simple enough? And is it clean? Can I use it? So preparing the data. So is it relevant? So here you see in this data set, there is a column about the price. Okay, that is quite relevant. But there is also a column VIN number. Is that relevant to answer the question? No, absolutely not. So just throw it away. Don't use it to train your algorithm. Then, is it independent? So is every column telling the same something different? And in this case, it tells you like the year and the age. So that is basically the same. So you pick one, pick the most simple one. And is the data simple enough? So that means, do I have like columns that have like very extensive information? So here you see the model is an encore, and all those subtypes. Just the first run of your model, just make something simple, and for this instance, use like just Ford Fiesta and not Fiesta 1.6, something like that. And then is it clean enough? So if you feed your model crap data, you will get crap answers. So clean up your data very well. So if there are weird values in, they can really influence your model. So you have to look through and make some selections and actually remove that bad data from your data set. And that takes a lot of time. So if you're now here, you have spent around 80% of your time of your project, because that clearing of the data takes very long and is actually very boring. So when you're done, you can select that algorithm. And luckily for that, there are a lot of cheat sheets on the internet. So you just follow the arrow, and you will come to like 5 algorithms that might solve the problem for you. So, and you don't have to pick one. Pick them all 5 and make your machine learning compete and see which algorithm actually performs the best. So you have chosen 5 algorithms, and then you can start training your model. And the basic process looks like you import data, you do still some pre-processing, you split the data, like 20% for testing, 80% for training, or whichever division you want. You train it, later on you score it against your test set, and then you evaluate your model and see how it performs. And in Azure Machine Learning Studio, it looks like this. So left and right, you see 2 different algorithms. They run, and the results are gathered, and you see in a score which one is the best. So which one performs the best on the test set. And when you're done, then actually the fun for the developer starts. You can start using it actually in your solutions. And it can be wrapped up in a Docker container as an API. So then from a developer's perspective, it is just calling an API. Azure Machine Learning Studio can do that hosted and give you like cool metrics on how it works. You can also put it like in an Azure function. It will just run. And you can deploy it to like a Raspberry Pi or any other device. It's just a piece of code, eventually. So if you're doing this process, take a good note at what your data is. Like I said, crap in, crap out. And limited data will always give you limited answers to your questions. So back to this important question. Is it a cat or is it a dog? So we can use the computer vision API to answer that question. And it will answer that question for you. So, and you don't need actually to train a model because this problem is already been solved. So if you send this image to the computer vision API, you can go to the Microsoft website and just click browse, and you get back that this is actually a dog, and it will tell you where the dog is. And it is even smart enough to see here that there is also a cat. So that is pretty cool. And it also gives a description. It is a dog looking at the camera for you. So that's quite cool. So, but it gives you like way more cool things. So this is a Jupyter notebook. And this is the tool most data scientists use if you want to run Python code. So you have cells, and in those cells you type some code, you click a play button, and it runs, and it remembers the state of your notebook between cells. Very easy to prototype and to do things. So all these cognitive services have SDKs. They have it in Python, they have it in C#, and Java. Doesn't matter, it is there. So you can import it and use it. From there, you connect to an API, and these APIs you create in Azure. So you go to your portal and you create the API. You run it through, and then you can run a bunch of images through. So if you run a bunch of images through and ask, give us the text you see for these images, if you run my test set that I got from Kaggle, it sees a dog, it sees indoor, it sees floor, it sees a cat, it's indoor, and the cat is somehow sitting, it is a dog. So that is just out of the box with like 10 lines of code. It can also give you descriptions, so a small white dog looking at the camera, or if the dog looks a little bit too much like a sheep, it will tell you it is a sheep on top of a wooden fence. But it is quite accurate that it can see that it looks actually more like a sheep. There's some more features. So very important, what will it tell us about our picture? So you can ask some things. Hey, is it an adult image? You can ask image type. You can ask, hey, what kind of colors are in there? Give me the text and give me a description. So this image is not classified as adult content. It's not classified as racy content. And racy content means that in some countries, it is might considered not appropriate. So if you have like a sensitive website, run it through this and it will tell you, maybe you should not post that on your website. It'll tell you about the colors. So the dominant foreground color here is white. It's has a lot of gray and this accent color. It is not a black and white image. And it will tell you it is not a clip art, so it is not a drawing. And the description is like, it is a dog looking at the camera. So with one API call, you get all this information out of the box for an image. So if this is your question that you have to answer, is it a cat or is it a dog, you can just use this API. But hey, it is way more fun, of course, to make it ourselves. So let's level up a little bit and go to the custom vision service. So the custom vision service is a tool where you have where you can upload a bunch of images. So you upload a bunch of cats, you upload a bunch of dogs, and you tag them, hey, this is a cat, and this is a dog, and you hit the train button. So tag the images, run them through the custom vision service, and hey, you have your model. And it works as a classification thing. So if you send an image to the endpoint there, it will tell you, hey, I'm 99% sure that this is a cat. And it works with almost every big enough object. And the minimum amount of pictures you need is 30 per object. And one of the cool things about the custom vision API service is that you can actually export these models and can use them in your own application. So you're not bound to Microsoft and calling their API and pay for every request. So you can export it to a Core ML model that will run on your iPhones, on the TensorFlow model that, of course, will run on your Android, but also on Windows and in Python and everywhere. Or on Linux, that will run natively on Windows 10, so it will also run natively on a Raspberry Pi running Windows IoT. And you can get it nicely wrapped in a Docker container and deploy it to a Kubernetes cluster or wherever you want. So if you want to do this, you have to do three steps. So you have to prepare, of course, your data, because you need to have good data, then actually upload it and train it, and then start using it, and that can be in various ways. So on Kaggle, I told you there are lots of data sets, and there is also a cats and a dogs data set that actually has 25,000 images of cats and dogs for you, nicely sorted. So getting the data is just downloading that file. So if we have a look at another Jupyter notebook, then we started preparing the data. So I will sort my data. These are cats and these are dogs. So, and in this data set, what we saw, there are lots of cats and dogs. So I create a project, and for that I need a training key and a prediction key. And this is actually the same what you can do, what you did with the other API. You go to the Azure portal and say create new key, and you get your keys. So you train it, you create a project. In this case, it is cat or dog project, and I select a domain. And there are a lot of different domains you can choose, and it will already help you make your model better. So if you're going to make a food classifier, because you want to have that, you can choose for food, but it can also be for retail if you're doing something with clothes. And you see here, not all the types, all the domains, are exportable. So if you want to run it locally, choose wisely here. So then you create some tags, you start uploading some images and add them to the tags, and then you start training the model. So if you go to the Custom Vision website, there is also a UI, and you can do it through code. I like it to do a little bit more through code because I can actually commit it to a Git repository and version all the steps I have done. And if someone accidentally deleted it, I can actually redo it. So, but you can get to the portal, and there you can see what you have done. So I have a cats and dogs project here, which just contains a lot of cats and dogs. And you see here I have 250 cats and 250 dogs, uploaded, nicely tagged. So it starts training, and the training of this model with 500 images takes 1 minute, 2 minutes. So it is very fast. Then you can start testing it. So you post an image to the endpoint, and you get back, hey, I'm 99% sure that this is a cat. I'm 100% sure that this is a dog, and 0% sure that this is a cat. So this works by out of box, by uploading there, training, and calling the API. So this you can do with your own images also. But most of the projects, you don't want to be dependent on the API from Microsoft. So you can start exporting them. So you can ask, hey, give me all the exports from this training round. And then you can download it. So it will export it, and generating the model will take like 5 minutes, and then it is ready for download. You get back a zip file. In that zip file, there are two files. There is the model file, it actually contains the model, and there is a labels file that says cats and dogs. So you run it through, and then so you load in the model, that's just TensorFlow SDK, you load the model, and then you can start predicting against the model. So here, this exported model will just say, hey, this is a dog, this is a cat. And then you're done, and you can put it in your own projects. But yeah, you still don't have any control with this about which algorithm is being used. Microsoft decides, and Microsoft can change it. And most of the times they make it better, but sometimes they don't, and you just don't know what it is. So if you're really going to do a custom model, you need to have full control about what you do with the code behind and how the model is being trained. So if you zoom back to the Azure Machine Learning overview, we are going to use now Azure Machine Learning Services together with Keras, it's a deep learning framework, and use some GPUs to train it from scratch and deploy it as an Azure to an Azure container instance, of course, in Azure as a Docker container. So Azure Machine Learning Service is a fully managed cloud service that enables us to like easily build and deploy and make the process like a little bit DevOpsy. So it will version a lot of things for us. Keras is a high-level network API what actually lives on top of the frameworks like TensorFlow. So TensorFlow is very complicated and you need like a lot of lines to get something done. And Keras is like made to make that a little bit more bearable. And so if you have like 10 lines of Keras, translates into like 200 lines of TensorFlow. So use Keras, it is much easier to understand what is going on. So also for this, we need to take a few steps. So first we have to prepare our environment. The setting up of the environment will take a while. Then we can start experimenting. We can do experiments over and over and over again. And then we can start deploying our experiment, our model to the cloud. And of course, we're going to answer the same question, is it a cat or is it a dog? So preparing our environment. It can be done in three different ways. So you can just click Azure Machine Learning Service in the Azure portal, and it will create all those things for you. You can do the same from Visual Studio Code with Microsoft AI tools installed, or you can do it with a Python SDK from an Azure notebook or a Jupyter notebook. And Azure notebooks, I just hosted the Jupyter notebook, so it will again save you all the time of installing all the different Python versions and TensorFlow versions. So if you do that, so if you install or click or create the Azure Machine Learning Service, you get six components, which you're all going to use. So there is compute. Under the compute tab, there are your batch AI clusters that will spin up and do actually the training. There is the top experiments, where all your machine learning experiments are being versioned. So you can see there every experiment you've done and how well it was performed. There are data stores, where you can version all the data you've used, because also your data changes, of course, when you create a model. There is actually a model store. So if you're happy, you can register your model there. And then from the model, you can create images. It will create automatically Docker images for you if you want. And you can use the deployment tools to actually deploy that to Azure Container Instances. So if you have a look at the real Azure components you get, of course, a workspace. But the data store is nothing else than just a regular blob storage. There is a key vault, which has all your secrets. There is a container registry where all your Docker images are registered. So you can also pick it up from there. And there's application insights that is used to track how your experiments are going and do all the reporting for you. So creating a workspace. So this is just Python code you can run. You create a workspace, give it a name, give it a link to your subscription, think of a nice resource group name, where you want it, say create, and then you can write down the config. And then you can later on load your workspace from config, so you don't have to check in actually all these credentials and all this sensitive information. The second thing you need to do, so you have your workspace, the second thing you need to do is create the compute that is actually going to do the deep learning for you. So you see here, I create a compute target, give it a name, and then you just say, I want this virtual machine size, and spin up like one node, one minimum node, and you can spin up maximum of six nodes for this. So this is a standard NC6 machine. It costs €600 a month if you don't shut them down. And they have one fair GPU to do the deep learning for you. So you say create, and it will just create a cluster for you. And those machines are pre-installed with all the frameworks again. So that is really handy. Takes 15 minutes for your cluster to be up. So if you do this, be careful and set minimum nodes to zero. Otherwise, your boss is not going to be happy with the credit card bill after a while. The third thing you need to do is attach storage, because it needs to get the data from somewhere. So you can get the default data store. That is the blob storage that is being created when you created your machine learning project. But you can also mount any other blob storage you want. So let's see how that works in code. So we go to another Jupyter notebook. So first you start with importing all your Python packages you will need for your project. And here you see I just gave it some names, my subscription, and then I can load my config from a config file. And it will put it in the directory AML config, config.json, so you can ignore that in your git ignore file. So when you loaded your workspace, you can ask all the details from your workspace. So you see here the name, where it is, your workspace ID, when it is created, but you also see which container register it uses, which storage account it is currently using, which service principles it used. So all the information is in this, you can access with this small Python command. So the workspace is set up, and you start creating your compute. So here, creating an NC6 cluster. And when it is created, you can also ask the details from it. And you see here that I have one node pending. It's actually doing nothing and just billing my credit card. And that there is nothing actually being trained. So what you normally do is you set it to 0 nodes, and then it goes out in like 5 minutes or 10 minutes when it is not being used, and it will shut itself down. So you can mount your default storage, because you need the storage. Or you can create a link to any existing blob storage there is. So that is it. 3 things you need to do before you can get started. Create a workspace, create your compute cluster, and attach your storage. So when that is set up, you have to do that once. You can start experimenting with your model and with your data. So create an experiment. Of course, give it a name and tell it where your training script is going to be. So this Excel script, the train.py in this case, that is the script your data scientist will make and will give to you. And that has to be, of course, a Python file. But there they can just do whatever they want. So you create the experiment, and then you give it like as a parameter where the data store is. You say, hey, for the training, use a TensorFlow model. There is my script folder. These are my parameters. Use this compute cluster and execute this train.py file. Use my GPUs, because I have like a batch AI cluster. And then you can install extra Python packages you need by just giving that in the conda packages array. So install Keras, install OpenCV on this container, on this cluster for me. And then you can run it. So you have packed your configuration file, and you submit that to your cluster. And while it is running, because mostly it takes like 30 minutes for it to finish, you get back, you can ask, give me the run details. So it will stream you live everything it is doing, and it will draw these cool graphs for you in real time. So you see actually your model learning in real time in your Jupyter notebook, which I think is really cool. So when that is done, you had some coffee, you can register your model if you're happy with it. So let's see how it works a little bit more in code. So from the previous stage, we had our workspace. We had our compute cluster, and we had our data store. So we create an experiment, in this case, CAD or doc. We tell, hey, our training py is here. And if you look at that Python file, we see that we can get parameters injected in it. So here, the data folder is just given as a parameter to this file. So what I do here first is I'll prepare the data, because I have to shape all my images to like the same size, make them black and white, and do some more preparation. When that is done, I can start with the actual training. And this is actually the training script that will train the model in Keras to classify if it is a cat or if it is a dog. So compile the model. And then very important, when you've done that, you have to save your files, your model files you have created, to a very specific directory. And that is called the outputs directory. So everything you want to have saved and copied back to your Azure notebook or to your Jupyter notebook, you have to save in that file, and it will automatically be put in Azure Machine Learning Service. You don't have to do anything for that. So when that script is done, mostly done by data scientists, we'll give you. You give your estimator, in this case a TensorFlow, and I say explicitly, I'm here install Keras this version and pip this version. So be very specific with your version, because Microsoft will update the versions for you and not tell you. So I had lots of times that things changed and it didn't work. So I learned the hard way, put your version numbers there and you're sure it will work. So here you see log files that are being streamed back. So everything you print to the screen in that training pie, you can actually find back in this log file. And it is also versioned and copied in Azure Machine Learning Service. You see some cool graphs. The model is performing okay. It's not very good. When it is done, I can ask, hey, give me all the files. And here you see the two files where it is actually be about, my weights and my model. And these are the two files I want. So I download them from Azure Machine Learning Service and have them now locally on my notebook. So here I download it. And then when I've downloaded them, those files, I register them as, under this very cool name, my model. And now everything is versioned in the cloud and the whole process is be traceable to the log files and to everything that I've been done, even the data set I've been used. So now we didn't even see until this far how it actually worked, the model. So we can quickly load in the weights and the model file on my local computer, and then we can start evaluating the image. So here I have dog one as an image, and here you see it will classify it as a dog. But I also have a cat image, cat one, and if I click run, it classifies this one as a cat, luckily. So, we were here. So what have we seen? Because the process is quite, there are a lot of different steps going on. So first, when I submitted that estimator, it took a snapshot of the folder where that training file is in. And you can put more helpers in it. And it sent it to my experiment in Azure. There, it created a Docker image with the TensorFlow and all the things installed, including my training PI file. It deployed that Docker image to my compute target, to my cluster, and then it mounted my data store, my blob storage, to that Docker image in my cluster. It launched my training script, and then it started streaming the log files through my experiment back to my Azure notebook. And when the training was done, it copied over the output back to my experiment. So step three was create an experiment, create your training file, configure the experiment, like which frameworks and which things I have to use, run it, and register the model. Then the last step. Deploy your model into production. So to do that, you need three things. You need actually the model we've just made. You need a scoring PI, so the file that's been executed when the request comes in. And you need an environment file that will tell you, hey, which packages and which things do I need to have installed. And that will result in a Docker image that will be placed into Azure Container Registry. A scoring pi looks like this. So we have an init function that is being executed when your local container starts. And then you have the run version. And that is everything something is being posted to the endpoint of the Docker container. So you load in the model, and then you just process the image and run it through your model and return the output of the classifier. The environment file is a Conda environment file, and you will just say Conda add package, Keras this version, and use Python this version, use pip this version. So you just define all the packages you want to have there. And also include the version numbers, because your version numbers through the whole chain have to be the same. So when you've configured that, you have those three things, you can actually create the image. And you just say, create this container image, use a Python runtime, use this scoring PI, and use this environment file. Use this model, and go for it. And the creation of the model, you don't have much influence on the speed. So depending on how fast Microsoft wants to do it, is mostly done in 15 to 20 minutes. So you have to wait for that. And then your image is registered, and you can see actually in the portal where it is, but you can also look it up in your Azure Container Instance. So if you don't want to use Azure Container Instances or something else, you can pick it up from the registry yourself and do whatever you want and deploy it to Kubernetes or what you want. So it is just a Docker image from here. But you can also deploy it very easily with some Python commands to two things, to an Azure Container Instance that is like one Docker file running on that instance, or you can create with 5 lines of code a complete Kubernetes cluster where your model will be load balanced running. So to AC, it is just say use one GPU core, 2 MB, 2 MB, use this image and go for it. So that is phase 3. You need the scoring pie. Here in Excel, since it is a bit longer, so you load in the model. And here you run it through, convert your image, because the image has to go into like a certain way. It cannot be like this massive image, so you have to do mostly some pre-processing on it. And then just return the labels in this case. Create the environment file. Say again, hey, pip this, carry this, and install OpenCV. You can load all the models, go through all the models that are already registered, or use your last model, and then you can create your Docker image. So say Python, scoring file, my environment, and call the image this. Starts creating the image. This is my 15th version of the image. And then I can either create a new Azure Container Instance, or I can update an existing one. And because it is an Azure Container Instance, when you update one, it will go down for 5 minutes before it is booting up again. And if anything goes wrong with the deployment, you can always ask the service, hey, give me all the logs, and you get like a very, very long log file from it back. So then when the endpoint is running, so when ACI is happy and it's running, you can ask, hey, give me the URL from this endpoint. And then you can just start sending random images to that endpoint and see what results come back. So here is a bunch of random images from the internet. Here. And you see these are cat, it's a dog, and also this one classifies as a dog. So deploying a model, you have to create a Docker file, and you have to deploy the image to an Azure Container Instance. So if we zoom back a little bit to what we have seen, you can prepare and pre-process the data with any tool you like. You can use any IDE you like. You can use Visual Studio Code. You can use Jupyter Notebook. It doesn't matter. Then you can train and test your model in the cloud, using the machines from Azure and from Microsoft. You can register and manage your model very easily. It can help you build these Docker containers, and then it can also help you to deploy those Docker containers to production. So the 3 steps: prepare, experiment, and deploy it and use it. So to solve this problem, we saw 3 solutions. Computer vision, out of the box, you don't have to do anything. Computer vision, you just upload a bunch of data and it works. Or you can use Azure Machine Learning Service to do it completely from scratch yourself. So thank you and enjoy the beer and the party.